I teach at Cal State Fullerton, and when students come in late, I make them sing in front of the class. But I'm not going to do that here. Instead, I will sing. And it affords us welcome. What's your name?
Claudia.
Claudia, welcome, Claudia. And this slide is a little tired for people. Well, bless my soul, what's wrong with me? I'm nothing with no fuzzy tree. Don't say I have my fire like a bug, I'm in love. Come on, that's it. I have been encouraged to try to be more interactive with an audience. So when I'm in love, if you could just join me on a hook, that would be very helpful for me. So, let's see. Well, listen, my soul, what's wrong with me? I want you to come in and on a fuzzy tree. My friends all say I'm acting wild like a bug. I'm in love. I'm talking about this down home, get greedy, silver lake, kind of, right? Let's try it again. Well, this is so wrong with me, but you're not gonna hang on a fuzzy tree. My friends all say that while I'm above, I'm in love.
This up again. The story, well, flat out, I don't have the full story of Mako's life. You can't, I mean, 73 years old when he died, that's a big amount of life. And it isn't like we hung out together, but I did observe. So this is a brief thumbnail of his life and what he's done. And let's get this started.
Hello, my name is Don Magwili. It is my honor to talk to you about Mako, Annie's Most Players, the oldest working theater of color in the United States. Mako Yomatsu was born December 10th, 1933, and died July 21st, 2006. Mako was born Makoto Yomatsu in Kobe, Japan, the son of noted children's book authors and illustrators Taro and Mitsu Yasha. Shortly before the outbreak of World War II, his parents, who were political dissidents, moved to the United States, leaving Mako in the care of his grandmother. After the war, his parents were able to arrange for him to join them. He enlisted into the military in the 1950s and became a naturalized American citizen in 1956. During his military service, he discovered his theatrical talent and trained at the Pasadena Community Playhouse. He has been nominated for numerous awards. Most notable was his Academy Award nomination for Best Supporting Actor in the movie Sam Pebbles Opposite Steve McQueen. Most of his acting roles credited him simply as Mako. He has a star on Hollywood Walk of Fame. He was a resident of the Silver Lake area. As an introduction to Mako, I found these video clips in the documentary by Jeff Adachi entitled The Silent Screen. In them, you will see Mako talking about Tetsuo Hayakawa and the state of Asian Americans in Hollywood, and a brief biography of his work.
Many people know Rudolph Valentino. He was a sex symbol of earlier Hollywood. But don't forget, Tetsuo Hayakawa was prior to him, and according to some researcher, Tetsuo Hayakawa was the first sex symbol of Hollywood. He was certainly appealing to many, many people in this country, all over the world. I recall having a meeting with executives of Warner Brothers about David Carradine portraying a Chinese character in Kung Fu. And I remember this vice president, one of the vice presidents in charge of production, I suppose, said, if we put a yellow man on the tube, audience would turn the switch off in less than 5 minutes. And I got really red in the face. And I said, wait a minute. And I went back to this point of sexual alcohol, you know. But I guess he was too young to remember. Maybe his grandmother would have said, yes, Sesue was my idol. Don't get into stereotypic image, you know. Stereotypic image is the simplest and easiest way to do it, but you will not get, performers will not get satisfaction out of doing it. Only satisfaction may be your bank account may be a little fatter. That's about it, you know. Is that worth having that kind of a record on your soul? I used to play hooky from school and go see, you know, a lot of old movies. I did see a lot of, you know, Hollywood war films. And there were Richard Lube and Philip Kahn, mostly, you know, those two were sort of playing prominent so-called Japanese soldiers' parts, you know. And I thought to myself, you know. Anyway, that was my reaction. But at that time, I wasn't thinking about becoming an actor. You know, I could do better than that. You know, that's why you didn't think about actor like Richard Lou. When he did a film called Steel Helmet, where he portrayed a Japanese American soldier involved in a Korean conflict, to me, that was the best thing that he's ever done.
Yeah, in our country we have rules, even about war.
Were you one of those idiots who fought in Europe, for your country?
442nd Combat Team, and you know what? Over 3,000 of us idiots got a Purple Heart. You can't figure that out, Major, can you?
No, that's what I don't understand. They call you dirty jack rats, and yet you fight for them. Why?
I've got some infantry news for you. I'm not a dirty Jap right now, I'm an American. And if we get pushed around back home, well, that's our business. But we don't like it when you get pushed around back.
Mako, before I forget the articles of war and snap those rabbit teeth of yours off one at a time.
Once I decided to become an actor, my objective was to be as good as Marlon Brando. Or Laurence Olivier, you know.
Mako has made over 80 feature films and appeared in more than 100 television shows. He also founded the East West Players, America's oldest Asian American theater company, which has helped train thousands of actors. In 1966, 11 years after Tetsuo Hayakawa was nominated for an Academy Award, Mako became the second Asian American male to be nominated for his role in The Sandbells. Although he did not win the award, he set a new standard of excellence for those who would come after him.
I have a question. The East West Players was founded by 9 Asian American artists: Mako, Ray Creevy, Pilipo, Sutiko, J. Tong, Pat Lee, Jun Kim, Guy Lee, and Yen Wok. These were players listed out in 1965 because of this, again, from the slanted screen.
However, actors such as Sushi Hayakawa, Jane Shigeta, Mako, and Bruce Lee, and the roles that they played were the exception, not the rule. From the very beginning of Hollywood, Asian male characters were portrayed by actors who weren't even Asian at all.
My boy, if silence is golden, you are bankrupt.
Two forces in the universe. One against the other is sinister. It is said that the devil plays men's souls. So is Dr. Fu Manchu. Satan himself. Evil incarnate.
Either there were no roles, or there were minor roles, or the good Asian roles did not go to Asians. So according to Yuko Kurahashi in her book Asian American Culture on Stage, prominent actors James Hong and Bill Guo wanted to form a theater group to train and do productions to show Hollywood what they could really do. They approached Mako, whose background was with the Pasadena Playhouse. He emphasized solid acting training for the stage. Their first production was Russian. Mako was cast as the bandit, Jun Kim played the wife, Sutiko played the husband. It was a critical success, but it was a struggle. Actors came in, actors left. Directors came in, directors left. They approached Mako to be the artistic director of this small group of actors. He would hold on to that position for 24 years. He left that position in January 1989. Lawrence M. Miller, in his book Barbarians to Bureaucrats, describes a cycle of organizational life, starting with the prophet, someone who comes up with a philosophy or idea, whether it be a business organization. Then it takes the leadership of a barbarian to essentially bully the organization through the stresses of a startup company or a religion, to a builder explorer, to an administrator. I have always seen Mako as the barbarian in this scenario. Everybody wants to criticize the leader, but nobody wants to do any work or carry the load or be responsible. In the 1960s, 70s, 80s, the East Coast Players was a shaky, hit-and-miss, 99-seat, non-profit theater club. I'm talking about the 4424 Santa Monica Boulevard, East Coast Players. Sometimes the plays we needed weren't there. Sometimes the actors we wanted weren't there. For 24 years, Mako was there. He was the artistic director of the East Coast Players Theater. Under his watch had come Tony-winning playwrights, directors, designers, and actors. Generations of skilled working actors. These last words will be Mako's, again, from the slanted screen.
The vision I have for myself, and the vision that the younger generations have, may be a different. Maybe that the younger generation is more success-oriented. Once I make it, I can make things happen. You know, that type of attitude. But my word of advice to them is that one man alone cannot do it all by himself. I think you need collective effort to rectify the injustice that have been piled up among them and buried in our past.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mako.
Seeing the programs of their 10th
annual banquet anniversary. My agents turned out to be Mako's agents, but I didn't know. My agent said, why don't you go see his theater? And I said, Mako, what kind of name is that? An Iron theater? But I went down, and I have a public confession of a different soul, and I have to tell you. I trained over the American Conservatory Theater in San Francisco for 2.5 years, and I was there. I must be one of 5 trained actors in those days, Oriental actors in the country. So, you know, hot shit. I'm sorry. But I came down to see their play, and they were doing Jungle in the Cities by Brecht, and I saw like 30 Asian American performers, no accents, performing, and it rocked me in a very deep way. In 24 years, under Mako's sort of like guidance, I found myself developing. I wrote my first stage play because Mako gave me a grant, Rockefeller Playwrights and Residence grant. I got 2 of those from Mako. I directed my first stage play through him. My appreciation of who I am as a Filipino American, it's very interesting. I got to that by way of working through Mako. And in those days, see, Mako, who was an immigrant, his wife, Susie Hoshi, who was an immigrant, there's a very deep, like, Japanese strain through the theater in terms of its culture and what it's doing. I knew how to fold a kimono, like, legitimately, because of the things that we did. But also, under his auspices, I found myself doing Filipino-American work. And that took me to a different place. And so part of my growth as a human being came out of that. I wrote a lot for the East West Players, and I cut a deal with Bob. Let's see. Do we have 300? I think I've got a photograph of the old 4424 Santa Monica Boulevard theater. Because it doesn't exist anymore. It's, let's see. It's now a parking lot. What's left is really just the sign. Can you see that? That's what it was. It was an architect's warehouse. My understanding was, apart from the sign and the concrete floors, that was all there was. And it was the workshop members and Mako, they built everything. Daniel, were you there when they made the wooden
room? Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
I was there from the beginning.
From that space?
From that space, yeah.
Were you there at the church also?
I was not at the church.
You were at the church? What was the name of the church?
I think it was Presbyterian Church of some kind. Bethany.
Bethany Church. Well, my understanding is it went from Bethany to a space across the street from this place that didn't work out. And then they found this place.
A block away.
And then they found this place. And essentially, they made it into a theater. It's like if you want something done really, you really must do it yourself. So, yes?
Literally, when I walked into that space, uh-huh. It was the night that they were bringing stuff over from the other space.
Wow.
Yeah, so like I said, I was
from
that space.
From that space in particular.
From the very beginning.
Yeah. And now this apartment.
Yeah.
But the sign's still there.
Yeah.
If you go by there, it is now an adult health care, take care center. So I the deal I cut with Mako for these plays is instead of getting a royalty, I would take a night. He would give me a night there. And I used it to work out my one-person show.
in which I have built the song. I am an actor. A, C, D, O, R. Act for act. Talk for talk. So, I don't have to tell you, but you get very little respect when you announce that you're going to be an actor. Somebody says, yeah, I'm going to be an actor. I'm going to go into acting. He says, so what are you going to do for a living? I want to get into acting. He says, yeah, but when are you going to get a real job? My relatives, and they will come up to me and say, you know what you ought to do? You ought to get yourself a series.
Talk.
learned from when he was, he went to Broadway to do Pacific Overtures. Now, I think I'll give you that quote.
And then he gets up and goes, well, we all go to the restaurant. The restaurant is a local bar.
Mako angry, and I have seen Mako frustrated. But this is one of the few times I ever saw Mako, for the moment, content. It was a very special time. After Mako as the artistic director, the East Coast Players Theater, came Noble McCarthy, who became the artistic director from 1989 to 1993. She was followed by Tim Dang, who went from 1993 to 2016. It's amazing, it was almost as long. About as long as Mako's. Almost a quarter of a century. The current artistic director, Sneha Desai, who was in the middle of his first year in this position. It is mostly a thankless, miserable job. I used the example of, you know, the captain of the Titanic, and you're looking at the glacier, and it's coming, and there's nothing you can do about it. That's position work. Many amazing things happened during this time up before Bobby. Capianucci, award-winning playwright. To start there, David Henry Wong had his mother playing rehearsal piano, and he was fixing the seats. David Henry Wong won Tony Awards for his production, for his play in Butterfly. Phil Kangatanda, his first musical, The Avocado Kid, was at his best players. It was the beginning of many things. Many things. I'm going to finish my stories. There are acres more, but no. I will show this story, and this story is not necessarily user friendly. There was a time early on at the East Coast Players Theater where factions began to develop within the theater. Once you get past, we ought to, as Asian Americans, be heard and our stories be seen. Once you get past that, and you step into the making of theater, you're bumping into the same issues any other theater has to bump into, which means ego, and purpose, and discipline, or lack of it. So, factions developed, and it divided between Mako and his crowd, and everybody else. And the administrator at the time, Norman Cohen, said, we got to air this out. So we had a town hall meeting. We all came to the theater, and people were going, blah, 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 and people said this, and people said that. And I observed this. At some point, it was like just mostly bitching and moaning on either side. Mako described his vision for Asian American theater, something that would be unique to us. And he didn't know what it was yet, but he had formed this group. It was called the Total Theater Ensemble. He had maybe, at the time I was there, maybe 10, 12 people. We worked on tumbling, we worked on music, we worked on costume. We did a lot of it. And he was hoping out of that group would come to see theater film. And I watched something that was very interesting. I turned to those people who were most critical of what was going on in the theater, and I watched them cave. And the lesson I learned from that is when you have a clear vision, artistic vision of what you need, what you want, it surrenders in front of discontent, disorganized discontent. I have never had a lead role during Mako's tenure. I had written a play that was rewritten by somebody else. So when I had dealt with Mako, it was always very much cautious. But I tell you, there was a time in 1985 when I agreed to be the artistic director of the Asian American Theater Company in San Francisco. I didn't last very long, I lasted about 9 months. But I tell you, I think I did that so that I too could somehow do what Mako. His influence on me is deep. I want to show you
this last piece.
It's the video that's used right now to promote East West Players and where they are now. I mentioned how, you know, at 4424 Santa Monica Boulevard, by golly, you know, sometimes you just didn't know if the check was coming in from the grant or what. You just hoped that it would. And yet we did theater. And now this is, we are, this is the 51st anniversary video. This is Snehal Desai, the current patient, artist director of East West Players, and this is their promotional piece.
Job be daunting. The first year in a new job be daunting. The pressure, the scrutiny, the high expectations. When I was named the new artistic director of East West Players, some people told me to ease into things, give myself time to adjust, and not push myself too hard. I didn't listen. Players ushered in a new era of celebrating and championing stories from the Asian and Pacific Islander communities. Last spring, we concluded our box office breaking 50th anniversary season with the close of Tim Yang's 23-year tenure as producing artistic director. Expanding on the strong foundation built by our founders, East West Players continues to keep our experiences relevant by producing challenging and thought-provoking work that honors our history and breaks down barriers through the power of storytelling. Located in LA's Little Tokyo District, East West Players is a gathering place for the community and a vital part of the economic growth in downtown Los Angeles. As the longest-running professional theater of color in the U.S., East West Players continues to advocate for equity, inclusion, and access on stage and in TV and film. We are a proud member of the Asian Pacific American Media Coalition, Theater Communication Group's Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Institute, and continue to lead the field with our groundbreaking 2042 Sea Change Initiative. We concluded our 50th anniversary season with the glitzy and glamorous La Cage aux Folles, which broke box office records, become the highest grossing show in East West Players history, and was hailed by the LA Times as the best of times. The 51st anniversary season opened with two co-productions, The Mama Bears in Concert and Road to Kumano, a partnership with the renowned Tycho Project. Last October, the EWP community participated in the 5th annual National Asian American Theater Conference and Festival, hosted by the Oregon Shakespeare Festival, a 10-day gathering of hundreds of APA artists where they discussed the state of Asian American theater, shared work, and explored new ways to collaborate and create. At the conference, EWP also launched our first think tank, made possible by the Forrest Duke Charitable Foundation. Last November, we staged the West Coast premiere of Kentucky by Leah Manapo Winkler. Subversive and heartfelt, Kentucky introduced us to two Hapa sisters coming together for a wedding, depicting a clash of cultures from Japan to the American South and from the city to the heartland. Our next production, Free Outgoing by Anupama Chandrasekhar, the National Theatre of London's first international playwright in residence, tells the story of a single mother in a conservative community in India, struggling to protect her children while caught between a country's embrace of new technology and adherence to old world values. Closing out our season is Next to Normal. Next to Normal will be directed by Nancy Keystone, the recipient of TCG's prestigious Alan Schneider Director Award, and brings Broadway stars Dee Magno Hall and Clifton Hall back to the EWP stage starting on May 12th. This year, East West Players has engaged more students than ever through its arts education initiatives. We've partnered with the Japanese American National Museum on Residence Elsewhere, our theater for youth show that commemorates the 75th anniversary of Executive Order 9066. Our Actors Conservatory continues to support professional training of actors, while our Alliance of Creative Talent Services, or ACTS, serves as a networking resource for sharing industry tips and information about the business of the entertainment industry. The Partners in Education and Arts Collaboration, or PEAK, brings professional artists into after-school programs. Our David Henry Walsh Writers Institute continues to grow at an unprecedented rate, with workshops of over 30 new plays this past year. Also, for the first time in its history, EWP launched a playwrights group. In honor of our radiant season dedicated to female artists, this inaugural group is composed of all female writers and led by award-winning playwright Alice Tuong. This year, we will also be launching the EWP Co-op, a residency program for veteran artists. As we look forward, Eastman Players continues its commitment to staying socially engaged as an inclusive, safe space for all, with collaborative events such as the After Orlando Project, Politics in Play, and the Secret Play Project. As we enter this new chapter in Eastman Players' history and plan for the next 50 years, we appreciate your support in illuminating and celebrating our story. I can't wait to see you at the theater. Thank you.
Final last words. Currently at East West, Next New Normal is ready. Yes, and we have flyers for them over here. You've seen the show, and we encourage you to go see it. It is rocking very much. Also, the book on the Silver Lake area is also. What I'm discovering as I end up teaching at college is there is no institutional memory. I'm dealing with young people that I have to explain what a Thomas guy is. So you guys know. I'm not letting you in. What are you doing on your phone? And if you do not have such pieces of literature, unless somebody just continues to tell the story, that stuff goes away. So the East West Players Theater is so, it keeps the story going, keeps the variety of stories going. Back in the day, back in the 70s, East West was really the only game in town. But Cold Tofu, Root to Improv, John Miyazaki's Here and Now, Theo's Golden Hour, not to mention, YouTube projects done by students, proliferate. Many more opportunities now for young Asian American performers specifically to have to hear their voice. But let me wrap this up, and then we'll be done. Mako is survived by his wife, Susie Hoshi, who herself is an actress and dancer director. His two daughters, Mimosa and Sala, are both grown now and have their own families. He is also survived by us, by the East West Players. Bigger, broader, better, more skilled, more dreams, more colorful than when it started. With no apologies. The East West Players is Mako's legacy, and it is still here. Thanks a lot. Yes, sir.
What, John? How do you get involved with the theater?
How do you get involved with the theater? ACTS, A-C-T-S, yes? What, Carolina, what can you tell us about ACTS?
ACTS is the Alliance of Creative Talent Service that the players offers. We have workshops. I think
history, they know Mako's work, they know the legacy that we have in Los Angeles, National Theater.
Also, they have no idea where to find skilled Asian American.
They have no idea.
So they go to the East Coast play.
So they'll call us for casting calls, and members of ACTS together will call for brand announcements.
So, to join East Coast Players Theater, it isn't like the workshop years ago. East Coast Players Theater is now a equity production company. But ACTS allows you to be part of the larger group of Asian American performers, and that kind of information is available. Also the conservatory, where you can take classes with actors and teachers who teach a number of disciplines, like playwriting, like acting, singing. Commercial group, I think, is Aaron Takahashi still teaching his commercial class? So that's going on. If you want to investigate that more, you can also check the website. You know, in today's world, there's a website, and yes, you can find it. Mm-hmm. So if you have any further questions afterwards, please ask them. Anybody else? Any other questions? Yes?
You spoke like a division that may the organization. I'm just out of curiosity,
you're
not one thing,
so I
apologize.
No,
how
was
that resolved?
It never really resolved, but it was like boiled at a glance. And in my observation, yes, there are critics and there are factions, but generally those who stay with the theater outlast the ones who criticize them. They will give way. And so, people learn to either endure or they move on. East West Players became, sometimes, you would find that actors either were repelled by the whole idea of East West, they didn't want to get involved in that kind of organization, or they went there. There was, and then they left, and they stayed, and they did some shows. East West had this kind of imprint with particularly the Asian American performers in Hollywood. They were either not going, or they were going and they left, something like that. It was today, not so much. I say that because of all the other venues that are now available. But in 1974, the only way to get into a play was to somehow either come to some kind of understanding with East West. Somebody else? You got something, Damon?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like you said. If you want me to talk, I have to talk.
You have a good story? You have any stories?
Not something. Any story.
Nothing you can say in front of children.
I can say a few things.
Please. You will wrap him up. System.
Yeah.
Oh, if you recognize him, he played the father. Ken Jones, Dr. Ken. That's big.
I just want to say, you know, for an actor to be successful, and I guess some people would say I've had a modicum of a success in the business. You know, a lot of people has to help you along the way. Okay? A lot of people, not just one or two. But certainly, the two people who made the biggest impact on my career was my high school drama coach, who got me started in the whole thing. And this is back in Houston, Texas, where it's segregated, racist. And he taught me one thing that I still sticks with me to this day. Because what happened was I was at a dramatic competition and I was doing something from Inherit the Wind. And I didn't win. But the judge who judged said, tell your coach that maybe you should do something from The King and I. I said, oh, okay, that was young. I didn't know. Yeah. So I went back to my coach. I said, hey, coach, you're not the judge. I said, I should do something from The King and I. And he said, and he blew up. Remember, This is in Houston, Texas. He said, you would not do the King and I. You would do exactly what I tell you to do. Okay? You just remember one thing. If you can't remember anything else I teach you, you're an actor. You can play any role you want to play. Okay? I said, okay, sure. But even then, it took me a long time before I actually got into, you know, acting. I came out to LA for that purpose. Because, you know, like Dom said, you know, your parents are against it. So it took me a long time, and finally I decided, I said, you know, I can't do anything else. You know, I tried. I failed at everything else I did in life. So I said, might as well give acting a try. So I decided one night, you know, late afternoon actually, I said, I'm going to go to East West Players. And I stopped by that theater. And immediately they put me to work. They said, go next door and bring the stuff over here. I said, okay. And that's how I got involved with East West Players. And through the time that I was there, I don't know, something like 15 years. I was the technical director. But more than that, for some reason, Mako liked me. Okay? Let's say, you know, Dom talked about fashions. Well, I was in the Mako fashion all those years. And I got it. He gave me opportunities. He gave me chances to fail. And let me tell you, I did not disappoint him many times. And, you know, and he kept giving me opportunities and opportunities. And I got to tell you, the reason why I got into acting was so I could have a voice. You know, it wasn't because of fame or money or any of the other trappings of acting. It's so that I could have a voice. And East West Players gave me that voice, gave me that opportunity. And I gotta say it, certainly back then, they weren't paying the technical director, and I wasn't making any money at East West Players, except once in a while, we would do some children's show, and, you know, slash COVID, we would do a lot of children's shows. But, you know, it didn't matter. Because I had a voice. I was able to express myself. And for that, you know, I was very grateful for East West Players and to Mako. And then when Mako was unceremoniously ousted, I think I was pretty much gone shortly after that. So, and you know, if you guys don't mind me saying it, but I thought when Nobu took over, I didn't think the theater had any direction whatsoever after that. So that's when I left. But, you know, thank goodness my film and television career started taking off after that. But anyways, that's my story. That's my Eastwood story. Okay.
Thanks a lot for spending time with us. Learn about Mako, learn about the East West Players there. Let me. I have.